Today we're talking about opioid addiction, one of the few problems your doctor won't give you painkillers to solve. Now, it's no secret that in America right now, we might be suffering from a pretty big opium problem. But don't worry, because we have top people working on it. Specifically, Kellyanne Conway, whose closest medical experience is working as a spin doctor for years. She's taking over for Jared Kushner in solving the opioid problem to give him more time to solve his lack of basic security clearance problem. Don't worry though, she's not alone, because heading the Office of National Drug Policy is a 24-year-old whose only previous work experience was working on the Trump campaign. But don't worry, he has a degree in political science from Fordham University, so under normal leadership, he'd be more qualified to get coffee for an assistant of the guy who currently has his job. That said, because he was the first person Trump saw after hearing about the opioid epidemic, he got the job. Now, the real worry here is that this problem seems to have become Trump's consolation prize. And, if you don't believe me, just know that Chris Christie got his own opioid commission. That produced 56 proposals that Trump acknowledged less than some of his unfamous children. So, how bad is this problem, really?
All right, for the first time in American history, deaths caused by heroin use have surpassed those caused by guns. New data from the CDC show there were nearly 13,000 heroin-related deaths in 2015. That's 10 more than gun-related homicides.
Well, I guess we have a new type of shooting up to be worried about now. So today we're looking at how this problem was reported by both CNBC and Fox News to get an idea about how both sides are dealing with the problem. First, let's address the elephant in the room, because recently we heard...
Some of these drug dealers will kill thousands of people during their lifetime. Thousands of people. And destroy many more lives than that. But they will kill thousands of people during their lifetime. And they'll get caught, and they'll get 30 days in jail. Or they'll go away for a year. Or they'll be fined. And yet, if you kill one person... You get the death penalty or you go to jail for life.
And I suspect this might anger some people, but when you put it that way, it doesn't sound that unreasonable. Although generally when you're copying the notes of the first leader outside of Africa to be investigated by the International Criminal Court for crimes against humanity, maybe you should think twice. Ah yes, the Philippines, one of the prettiest places to get killed by a government death squad. I should probably give it a little more thought before I support it. So what's Fox News saying about all of this?
Well, what do you think? Death penalty for drug dealers?
It's not changing the law. There's already a provision called the kingpin provision for those big traffickers that are busy selling a lot of illicit drugs.
All right, so what was this kingpin provision? This 1984 provision did a great job of reducing the rates of people complaining that there was no death penalty for dealing drugs, while accomplishing little else. It applies largely to criminals who would make Scarface look like your local high school drug dealer, and was about as much of a deterrent as a Financial Crimes Act is to big banks. The interview went on to say,
I don't know if the death penalty will actually decrease the amount of use, but it's sending a very strong message.
Yeah, we're not sure if it'll do anything, but we'll shoot first and ask why later. It does seem a little ironic to give the lethal injection to people for giving others lethal injections, though. Now, I do not want to poo-poo all over this idea, as some people think this will put teeth in enforcement, a phrase that this guy repeated like it was his prayer mantra. Although, he went further to acknowledge the argument that...
Do you think that's a solution?
Look, I want to point out that the death penalty is controversial in terms of its use as a deterrent. There's a lot of argument about that in states that actually have the death penalty have higher murder rates, so it's not clear that it's a deterrent.
Okay, he's doing a pretty good job arguing against Trump. Now, I'm not focusing too much time on the pro-death penalty argument, because, again, it was laid out pretty well in that Trump clip, and the argument's pretty clear. Most people don't want to die, so if you threaten them with death, they probably won't do something. It only gets complicated when you throw in morality, like those darn pro-life liberals who jumped all over this.
What about the death penalty?
I don't know if we should spend a lot of energy on that. I think meaningful sentencing will help.
What, CNBC? You guys, stop being so rational. It's really hard to moderate when everyone's being so straightforward. Don't forget, though, if you want the breakdown, the report went on to continue its non-judgmental information campaign.
Also in the White House plan, reducing the flow of illicit drugs, including online sales, cutting opioid prescriptions by one-third within 3 years, expanding access to treatment, asking Congress to allow Medicaid to pay for residential rehab.
In fact, the reception of Trump's policy is so positive. Just look at this clip called Van Jones Rips Trump Death Penalty for Drug Dealers Proposal. Oh yeah, are you ready to see this thing get ripped?
What are you thinking now?
Well, I'm glad that somebody's trying to do something. I was just in West Virginia. I like what the president said about helping to hire people, giving people second chances. I like what he said about being tough on the pharmaceutical stuff. I really like the fact that the First Lady gave a shout out to Lily's Place, where they're helping these drug addicted babies.
Not sure if you're going to recover from that rip. To be fair, he went on to say,
That is 180 degrees from what the people on the ground are saying. They're saying people need more help, more compassion, more education.
That does seem a little strange, though, because I'm legitimately curious about this. Is he saying that drug dealers need more help and compassion? I get it, but hearing that Trump speech and thinking he's talking about applying the death penalty to drug addicts would be like thinking the I Have a Dream speech was Martin Luther King describing his nightmare to a crowd of people. I feel like you missed the point, as you can help drug addict victims while still punishing drug dealers harshly. So honestly, it seems like people agree on the vast majority of what Trump's opium plan really is. So let's take a second to highlight the rest of the plan. First, we have
cutting opioid prescriptions by one-third within 3 years.
Now, this is boringly uncontroversial, but also pretty important. At first, this struck me as a bit strange, because while opioids clearly aren't good, they're still medicine. I couldn't imagine getting on stage and announcing that your goal was to cut hospitals giving out any other medicine by two-thirds to a roaring applause. Fewer painkillers for all! So I dug into the primary materials, specifically a White House press release. In a twist nobody saw coming, Donald Trump released a fact sheet. The main thing that jumped out to me was the Safer Prescription Plan. I like the sound of that. Now this idea was actually pretty awesome, so good job 24-year-old I was talking smack about earlier. In essence, it incentivizes states to take part in a national database monitoring opioid prescriptions, which would highlight many individuals requesting more prescriptions and doctors who overprescribe. I think the only thing controversial about this is, how is this not a thing 10 years ago? It would also apply more scrutiny to federally funded prescriptions, and it will ensure that at least half of all federally employed healthcare providers adopt best practices for opioid prescribing within 2 years, with all of them doing so within 5 years. Although I can't guarantee that's not just him trying a new method of cutting people's healthcare. The next big problem is this proposal attempts to
expanding access to treatment, asking Congress to allow Medicaid to pay for residential rehab.
Trump's proposing expanding Medicaid? Bernie Sanders won't need to use Viagra tonight! This would be huge, but first, to avoid any confusion, because I had to Google it, Medicaid is for poor people, while Medicare is for old people. This plan would expand Medicaid, the poor people one, to help poor people pay for rehabilitation. Which, again, sounds pretty great. So to conclude this proposal, it's boringly uncontroversial if you can look past the death penalty part. Which some people can, while other people can't. Now, before I go though, there is one other issue that has people on both sides lighting their torches. Naloxone, a thing that saves people's lives who overdose.
Learn to Cope has distributed hundreds of naloxone kits to its members, who have managed to reverse at least 9 overdoses.
Now, let's savor this moment of holding hands and singing Kumbaya, because this next part might piss you off no matter which side of the aisle you're on. Now, there are different levels of legalization of naloxone in different places. Some places say it needs to be prescribed, which, that's an awkward conversation. Hey doc, remember those painkillers you prescribed me? Well, now I think I might overdose on them, so could you prescribe me an antidote? Some places, though, allow for third-party prescriptions, meaning that you can buy them for yourself at any drugstore that has them without a doctor's note. And some truly crazy cities have made it so that if you administer the drug to anyone having an overdose, you can't be held legally liable if something goes wrong. In fact, it's sold at your local Walgreens. So what's the problem?
We have an Ohio sheriff. He refuses to let his deputies carry Narcan on duty. Joining me now, he is Butler County Sheriff Richard Jones. Sir, it's good to see you. Thank you so much for coming on the show. And, you know, you guys are in the front lines. You see an awful lot and have to contend with an awful lot. The question, though, is if Narcan can save someone's life, why don't you want your deputies to carry it?
Think carefully before you say anything, because these drugs have been found to be...
Healthcare professionals say the antidote is cheap, easy to administer, and has no negative side effects.
That sounds like an award-winning combination. Well, he won't let his deputies carry this because...
It's pretty simple. I want my deputies to go home at the end of their shift. They don't have to die because someone's using drugs. When the deputies get there or the law enforcement, they have to get down on their knees. They have to spray this in their nose. They come out fighting. And these people don't want them there.
Whoa, what? I try to be non-judgmental, but that guy's a dick. I mean, maybe there are some situations where you let them die without trying to save them, but taking away your ability to save someone who clearly doesn't pose a threat to you would be like taking out the Titanic without lifeboats. I mean, I know it's unsinkable, but maybe we should just be safe. I mean, heroin users generally look less like Macho Man Randy Savage and more like a twig in a beanie. Now, I do want to add a little to his argument, though, because it does raise one argument that, again, is either horrifying or legitimate, depending on who you ask. Because there is no Good Samaritan law for the police, so if they have the ability to save someone's life, they could be held liable if they choose not to. So, take away the choice by making them unable to save certain people? There is one other argument about limiting access to overdose cures, but it's more sociopathic than Kevin Spacey's character on House of Cards. Or, actually, his character in general.
Some people say Narcan is a lifesaver, the best chance to have people have to live another day and get into treatment. Others say it's just an enabler. People overdose on heroin, are revived with Narcan, and then repeat the cycle all over again.
Yes, the main argument against making this more available is that it's an enabler. Basically meaning that if you know you can be saved, you will be more likely to take some drugs. Which makes sense if you really, really try. Because over the last 20 years, I've seen the risk of death really be an effective disincentive for addicts to continue to take drugs. So this probably has triggered a few people, but let me put this argument in another, kinder way. This doesn't solve the problem, it just gives society a crutch that we can continue to ignore the problem. If opium stops killing people, society might stop helping the addicts, that it is no longer urgent. For liberals, it would be like if we really leaned into mental health and it managed to stop some school shootings, but guns were continuing to flow into the community at an increased rate. So, those are the two arguments and the two news items going on regarding opium right now. And honestly, on the whole, it looks like things are moving in the right direction. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, hope you enjoyed that last video. Be sure to click the subscribe button to get my regular feed. I post a few times a week, and of course, don't forget to like below. And as always, thank you for watching.